呢，我们非常荣幸的邀请到亚洲首位葡萄酒大师 Ginny Cho Lee 来到我们的直播间，为我们聚焦2015年波尔多七九。
谢谢，
有一个。基尼呢，接下来会先给我们做一个简要的波尔多七九的介绍。
I want to talk first, really, about the 2015 Bordeaux, because it's an on-premier that campaign that many people have had questions about, whether it was worth the value, whether on-premier system as a way to buy wine even before the wine is bottled makes sense.
今天呢，经理要谈到了。我们跟我们一起讨论的就是2015年的七九，很多人呢都会问他这样一个问题：波尔多七九，2015年的七九到底值不值得买？七九这个系统呢，是在你没喝到酒之前你就去买，到底可不可以
？So really understanding whether you want to buy on premier, whether this is something that you want to find out more about, I think really starts out by first understanding how is Bordeaux wines sold.From the chateau down to the final consumer.
你是否要去选择购买波尔多七九呢？实际上这是一个比较复杂的问题，有很多因素影响着它。然后呢，我们接下来先要去介绍的呢，就是波尔多的七九到底是怎么样从酒庄，传送到我们的消费者，传递到我们消费者的手上。
So the way Bordeaux wines are sold and brought to the market is a pretty complicated procedure because most wines go from the producer to the retailer and then to the consumer. But with Bordeaux, there are many, many levels and players and groups of people that work hard to distribute this wine that has huge quantities and, of course, many wines at very high qualities.
Bordeaux.葡萄酒啊，从酒庄呢到消费者的方式，实际上是非常独特的。很多的其他产区的葡萄酒呢，它都是直接从生产商，然后就到那个我们的进口商到零售商那里。但是波尔多七九呢，实际上它有很多的层级，它不是直接从波尔多的酒庄呢直接到消费者的手上。
So let's talk about where it starts from the chateau first. They make the wine.They may produce a few thousand cases to over 20,000 cases. Bordeaux has many large properties. And then it goes through a system called the Place de Bordeaux. This is the distribution system for Bordeaux. And the next step after the chateau is the courtier. The courtier is like a broker who goes between the négociants that are designated to sell Bordeaux wines.With the chateau, so they're the go-between, the chateau and the négociant.
首先呢，我们就要从酒庄开始说起了，这是第一步。酒庄呢，作为葡萄酒的生产商，它的每年的产量呢，大概有的小的呢，就是从譬如说1万箱，甚至到2万箱，甚至到10万箱等等，这是不等的。这些酒呢，实际上是通过一个叫做 Place de Bordeaux。这个分销系统来，进入到下一层级的，在酒庄之后的下一个层级呢，实际上就是那个 courtier。courtier 呢，它就像一个我们证券行业当中的一个 broker 中间商，它与酒庄呢实际上建立了非常非常紧密的联系。
So after the courtier, then you have négociants, and not everyone can be a négociant. You have to be registered.In Bordeaux to be able to sell wines from the chateau. And there are several hundred, and the ones that really matter and the ones that control the cru classé, very active, would be around 50 of these négociants. And they in turn sell to wine merchants, whether they're wholesalers, importers, or even retailers, all over the world.
在 courtier 之后呢，就是下一层级的Negotiant 要注意啊 ，Negotiant 跟 Wine Merchant 是有很大的区别的。Negotiant 呢，它实际上在 Wine Merchant 的上一级。Negotiant 呢，它是需要在波尔多进行注册，就是刚刚 Ginny 所提到的叫做 Register。他们呢，只有经过 Register 之后呢，才可以允许在波尔多去跟酒庄卖酒。 据统计啊，波尔多的比较顶级的酒庄呢，实际上是控制在15个宁沟雄手上。宁沟雄之后呢，就是那个 wine merchant 呢，实际上包含几大类型，一个就是像 retailer 啊、wholesaler 啊这些，像零售商、分销商等等这样一些角色。
So by the time the wines reach the consumer, you have gone through at least three different levels. And so the main question that people want to find out is why does it have to go through so many people?
一瓶波尔多的葡萄酒呢，如果经过这个系统去运行的话，它至少呢到达消费者手上了，至少需要3个层级。很多人就会问，为什么这样一瓶酒呢要经过这么多层级呢？到底有什么含义在里面？
Well, Bordeaux is the biggest fine wine region in the world. There's no other region bigger than Bordeaux for fine wines, even within France. And when you have wines, millions and millions of bottles a year produced, and they need to reach a final market, there has to be a very efficient system where, with just a few phone calls and a few emails, each one négociant, one merchant can reach thousands and maybe tens of thousands of customers, which allows the place, which we all know is the home of fine wine, can reach millions of consumers from around the world very efficiently and also very quickly.
波尔多的这些，波尔多呢，实际上是一个好酒的产区。实际上，甚至在法国，在全世界，它都是一个非常非常不错的顶级酒的产区。它寻找它葡萄酒的目标市场，实际上需要通过一种非常高效的机制来进行分销。波尔多的 Place de Bordeaux 实际上就是这样一种机制，它通过一个层级往下一个层级去推。到达 wine merchant 这一层级之后呢，每一个 wine merchant 可能接触到的 clients 可能有 millions of thousands of millions of 对吧？成千上万的各种各样的渠道，通过这样一种方式呢，让波尔多的顶级的好酒遍布全世界。
So for great vintages, and let's think of there are so many in the last 20 years, but let's start out with 2000 or 2005 or 2009, 2010. Most of these wines from the top properties, these wines were sold out within days. And that's because when the wines were offered through the system as a future, so the price is set by the chateau, then the négociant offers the price to the merchants who buy, and the merchants in turn have their own network of customers. Brings out a price, like for the 2015, this happened during the late spring and summer for 2016. And consumers see this price and decide very quickly, with just a phone call, who's going to buy. And many of these wines were sold out within days. To have that happen with so many chateaus, hundreds of chateaus who sell on Premier, is really unprecedented without a structure and a system like Place de Bordeaux.
波尔多的伟大年份呢、啊，像我们之前提到的2000年、2005年、2009年，还有那个10年，像这些年份当中顶级的酒庄呢，它通过 Place de Bordeaux 这个系统去销售，它卖出去的，实际上是在一天之内就已经全部售掉、售罄了。为什么他们通过这样一种高效的方式，譬如说从酒庄到那个 negotiation，他一个 offer 出去了，再到 wine merchant，他所接触的他自己的这些客户，通过这样一个高效的方式来进行运转。2015年的波尔多呢，实际上是从今年的春天就开始进行销售，就是每一年在4月份都有一个叫做波尔多的七酒品鉴周。那一周里面呢，很多的酒商、很多的那个 import 进口商都会通过自己的供应商去购买七酒。
The Bordeaux system has worked really well for the chateaus and the consumers for a very long time because consumers knew that they were getting these offers of wines that may not be available in the retail shelves. Or wines that they knew that they wanted in a certain format or at a price that they knew would also be less expensive than when the wine came out in the market 2 years later. So there were lots of reasons why people wanted to have futures as an option to buy Bordeaux. But times have changed and the Place de Bordeaux system has gone through so many challenges recently.
Place de Bordeaux 这个系统啊，实际上，对于酒庄来说呢，它运行是非常良好的。对于消费者来说呢，他们在很长一段时间之内也已经接受了这样一个分销的系统。在酒还没有上市之前，它可以以一种更加优惠的价格来买到，而且呢，可以去定制自己所想要的包装方式，譬如说，它是750毫升的，或者是它是 Magnum 的，这种各种各样的容量的这种方式。
So there were very high prices in 2009 and 2010, and people realized that when they bought vintages like 2010 at over €1,000, let's say, per bottle for some of the first growths. They realized that when the wines came out 2 years later, the wines could be less expensive. Instead of having saved money, it may not have been the best bet. So people in recent years, since the 2010 vintage, have had concerns. And you also had some chateaus, like Chateau Latour, one of the first growths, leaving the Empremeur system and deciding not to sell Empremeur. So the system has come under a lot of challenges and difficulties recently.
Mm-hmm.消费者呢是否会选择购买汽酒啊？这实际上跟很多的因素有关。价格呢，实际上是一个很重要的因素。譬如09年跟10年，这是两个非常不错的年份。当然，价格也是相对来说会比较高的。
So, why did Latour leave the system, for example? Well, it's because they felt that this was a system that didn't work for them.They would rather offer wines that were the wines were ready to drink. They would have these options of vintages that they thought the market would be able to accept. So it gives them more options. And in the last years, especially starting from 2011, 12, 13, and 14, have been challenging vintages, which the Empremeur system itself hasn't been able to accommodate because not all the wines have been able to sell.Through the future system as well as it has in the past.
拉图酒庄啊，实际上它是一个特例了，就是它在它是决定2012年的时候呢，就退出了波尔多七九这个市场，不再参加波尔多七九。这对于拉图来说呢，它到底是好还是坏？目前呢还没有一个定论。拉图呢，他退出七九之后，他有更多的选择，他可以去选择在自己认为合适的时候去发布、去上市，他认为已经达到了消费者可以去饮用或者非常适合去饮用的这些葡萄酒。但是呢，对于11年、12年、13年这些相对来说没有那么优异的年份，可能拉图。在这些酒就要把它留下来，他要保留自己的库存，这会无形当中对他自己呢也造成一定的压力。
Now we come to the 2015 vintage. It's very different. It is definitely the best vintage since 2010. So in this very really great vintage, we have some serious questions because the last several vintages have not sold very well, and.Even though the prices have come down, everyone wondered what was going to happen with the 2015. The result was that for the chateaus that offered the wines at the right prices, reasonable, and that weren't challenging the past pricing of the vintages in the marketplace, they found a very ready market because people were thirsty and eager to buy a great vintage.
2015年份了。是一个非常非常优异的年份。经理认为，它是2010年以来最好的一个年份。 这些葡萄酒呢，对于2015年来说，有些酒庄它在定价方面实际上显得是比较理性的，它以一个比较合理的定价来推出它自己的期酒，这样的话呢，就不会对自己以前年份定价造成一个挑战，然后市场上呢也有这一部分的需求来消化酒庄这边的库存。如果说他们的定价过高，那么势必会影响10年以来他自己本身库存的一些消化。
So, Scorpio, I'm sure that after this brief introduction about Ampemer and Place de Bordeaux, there might be some questions.
Yes, I'm sure I have some questions. 下面呢，我觉得就是说刚刚大师介绍到的这个 Place de Bordeaux, 实际上它无形当中啊会增加了酒庄在分销当中的一些成本。我们必须给那个库铁一些佣金，库铁就是中间的，我们必须给中间的佣金。那么这会不会导致我们消费者所买到的酒呢，会比直接那些进口商从酒庄直接去买，然后卖给消费者价格高呢 ？So, the question is that is, I just explained to the audience, you see, as to the system of Place de Bordeaux, inevitably the shadow has to pay for the commission to the courier, right? And it inevitably added the additional cost for the distribution of the wine. So my question is, if the bottled wine that going through this system, does it mean the wine consumer have to pay more than the wines that they buy directly from an importer that directly buy from the chateau?
Right. Well, first of all, in Bordeaux, you can't buy directly from the chateau. None of the top Cru Classé wines will allow you to buy direct from the chateau. There are some smaller chateaus that allow you to buy, but at the very top end, you can't buy direct. That's the first thing. So you do have to go through a négociant to buy. No matter where you are,
okay.
And the négociant has to go through a courtier.
对于波尔多来说，所有的顶级的酒庄呢，都是必须通过 Place de Bordeaux 这种方式来通过courtier， 通过 négociant 这样一种层级的关系来购买。没有任何一家顶级的酒庄呢，你可以去直接的从酒庄里面去进口葡萄酒。当然，波尔多一些小的、没有名气的酒庄可能允许你直接从酒庄里面去购买。
Well, and the other two major reasons. One is that the pricing of Bordeaux is very transparent. If you wanted to find out what is the ex-seller or ex-negociant price of, let's say, the 2015 or older vintages of Ampemer, you can find them very easily. It's all very well documented, which means that you cannot really...fool the customer and put really high margins because the customer already knows very clearly and the transparency is unlike any other market. They know what the price is, so they know how much you're making, they know how much the courtier is making. The courtier makes 2%, négociant can make as little as 10 or 15, and some years they can make more than 30. And then the merchant and importer can put...Again, as low as 10 or 15, or as high as over 30-40%. Depends on the vintage and the demand for the wine.
第一个理由啊，刚刚 Jenny 也开了一个玩笑，就是说不要把你的客户当猴耍，因为波尔多的价格啊，实际上它是非常非常透明的，消费者呢其实可以很容易的从网上去找到每一年的期酒的发布价格。尽管如此呢，这其实一点都不重要，关键的是你能买到这些酒，你能拿到这样的一个配额，而且呢，从库铁就是中间商，还有从 négociant 从那个 wine merchant 他们所惯例当中所拿到的一个 margin 就是利润来看的话， 像中间商呢，他是拿2%的佣金 ，negotiation 呢，大概他会赚一个10%到15%的一个毛利。然后接下来呢，就是 wine merchant 呢，他可能会是也是10%到15%这样的一个毛利。所以呢，整体的这个波尔多的价格是非常非常的透明的。
Why do merchants and all the players within Place de Bordeaux, why do they continue doing this if the margin is so low? Why is it worth their effort? Because Bordeaux, as we explained at the very beginning, is a region that's filled with quantity, so they have the volume to make it worthwhile. Think about one large chateau in the Medoc. They can be selling en premier from 200,000 to 300,000 bottles per year.And even if your margins are low, and if most of those bottles are sold through en premier, even 5%, 10%, 20% margins, because of the volume, can make sense.
实际上，波尔多啊是一个产量非常非常大的产区。如果说消费者担心呢，从波尔多酒商的这种像经销模式，就是相当于从酒庄到酒商。再到我们的分销商这样一种方式呢，会增加那个分销渠道的成本，其实一点担心都不用，因为它价格刚刚解释了，它是透明的。另外一个的话，它没有必要这么去做。
So Scorpion, now we are about halfway through the program. I think it might be a good idea to take some questions from our audience.
Sure.
And.What I do want to cover afterwards is about the different vintages of Bordeaux en premier, especially in around the last 10 years, and about some of the wines that I tasted. I was in Bordeaux in 2016, so spring of this year, to taste around 500 plus young Bordeaux wines in barrel, and I was very impressed with them.
刚刚经理也提到，就是说，因为我们这是一个直播的节目了。他在问我们有没有那个观众已经提出一些问题来，然后他也提到今年的春天呢，他在波尔多差不多尝了有超过500款的七酒，这些七酒呢给他的印象非常非常的深刻，所以下面的话呢，我们就来看一下我们有没有用户提到。这样的一些问题，有的，想啊 ，Right, I'll pick up one question that is, one of our audience say that, what is.The 2009 effect to the premier market of the later vintages?
That's a very good question because, well, maybe you should first translate the question.
这个问题就是说，09年这个比较不错的年份，还有它的一个定价的策略，对于09年之后，的年份。有什么样的影响?
The 2009 was a great vintage that everyone acknowledged was the best since 2005. And the unique point about 2009 was that it was such a generous, warm, almost a vintage and a style of wine that comes to hug you because of its approachability, even at a very young age.
09年份实际上也是一个非常伟大年份。它跟那个上一个年份就是05年的年份都是非常不错的。然后呢，这个年份的一个年轻啊，整体来说的话，它是一个比较温和、比较温暖的一个这样子。然后呢，它葡萄酒的一个特点就是亲和力会很强，就是不会让你产生一种在年轻的时候产生一种非常疏远的一种隔阂感。就像人比较亲切比较和蔼像吉尼这样
So 2009 was the first en premier vintage that the mainland Chinese buyers and wine lovers really got into They read about it. They started really understanding the Empremeur system and what Bordeaux wine was all about. And they got excited. So this was the opportunity for the market to really embrace China and to welcome it because of the huge demand.
2009呢，对于中国的葡萄酒买家来说也是个非常特殊年份，因为实际上2009年是中国的葡萄酒买家大规模的进入七酒市场的一个年份。然后这通过这样一种方式呢，让更多的中国消费者会去了解到七酒，接触到七酒，也慢慢开始理解七酒到底是怎么样的，它需要什么样。
So besides the China market embracing 2009, the other factor, and partly this was because of a whole new country opening their eyes to Empremeur Bordeaux, prices went up, so it hit record levels. So the effect of 2009 was really that the vintage had prices that people were dropping their jaws and being completely amazed. And it brought both positive and negative results from the market because some people said it's too expensive and others said, hey, if there are so many more people who are finally really appreciating all these fine wines from Bordeaux, let the market do what it does, which is supply and demand.
中国的买家呢，开始进入波尔多七酒这个市场，实际上对于中国来说，实际上意味着我们已经睁开眼睛去看外面的世界，葡萄酒世界是怎么样的了。有些人呢，对于2009年的定价，他认为过高，实际上呢，这是有好的一面，也有坏的一面，或者叫做它有合理的一面，也有不合理的一面。合理的一面就是说，很多人呢都已经在追逐，在期望去了解七酒到底是怎么样的。不合理的一面，可能有很多人认为它的价格偏高。
So 2010 prices were affected by 9 because there was such a big demand for 2009. When 2010, another great vintage came out, a lot of chateaus decided to increase prices. So that meant it created this spiral effect. And almost too quickly, both the economic situation changed, demand changed, and the wine prices, which were going higher and higher than after the 2010 vintage, started to decline.
接下来一年份呢，实际上在一定程度上啊，受到了当时的经济，还有2009年这个伟大年份的影响。所以呢，无论是从酒庄的定价策略方面，还是从它的实际本身的价格方面呢，都跟2009年有相当于是达到了一个顶峰。
So anyway, in conclusion, 2009 was a really, truly landmark vintage for a lot of reasons.
总结一下，就是2009年呢，无论怎么样，它都是一个非常不错的、非常伟大的年份。
Is there another question we can do? One more. Let me move on.
Check.They say, is it reasonable to buy 2009 right now?
Is it reasonable to buy?
对，刚刚我们有个观众问到，就是说，现在如果说购买2009年的葡萄酒，是它的价格到底是合理的还是不合理的？
I think it really depends on the chateau because some of the first growth, the top wines, really the 2009s were incredibly expensive. So if you look at the price and quality comparison, for example, or what you pay for 2009 of the same wine, you can get in 2008 for a fraction of the price. And depending on the chateau, I think that there are lots of great wines made in 2006 or 2008 as well. So that means, I think it's really chateau by chateau where it makes sense. But for the top Grand Cru Classé, the 2009 to buy now, only if you want to have it in your collection, but not to as an investment.
对于这个问题，对于这个问题，刚刚啊，回顾一下，
About whether to buy the 2009.
对这个问题呢，我们刚刚大师的解释是这样子啊，它是取决于酒庄，这个酒庄呢，到底是值得去买。还是不值得去买，要分酒庄而论。因为有些酒庄呢，它在定价的时候实际上是比较合理的，所以呢，这些酒庄呢是值得你去挖掘的，就像一片神秘的土壤，需要你去探索。这也正是葡萄酒世界的精彩所在，包括它的风味啊，包括它的价格。
Okay, so let's talk a little bit more about the different vintages that have been on offer, and you know why in Bordeaux the understanding the vintages really matters quite a lot.
年份呢，实际上对于波尔多葡萄酒啊，是的影响非常非常的大。
So we just talked about the effect of 2009, but this is the case for all the vintages that have come before. So when you look at vintages, for example, of 2000, which at that time.In 2001, when it was being offered, it was considered it was the most expensive Ampremer vintage, and lots of merchants and wine lovers were complaining and not so happy with the price, you know, increases. But it's proven that 2000 vintage was actually not that expensive in comparison to the prices that came before.
像2000年份当时出来的时候啊，有很多的消费者都认为。或者买家都认为当时的汽酒价格是非常非常的高的，但是实践证明呢，在历史看来，对比以后的年份，它的价格并不是那么的离谱。
So what you find is that the vintage that comes just after a great one, like 2001, ends up being great value. So whether you bought them on Premier or later in bottle, you find that a lesser vintage, even though it may not be as great.Can often be overshadowed because the great vintages cast this great shadow and influence on the vintages that come after. So 01 was a great vintage, especially in the right bank, and the prices don't really reflect it. So the vintages matter not just for that price, but for the vintages after.
刚刚经理说到了，就是在伟大年份的前后啊，你也可以去发掘一些。像非常具有性价比的年份还有酒庄，这是一个你如果你认为伟大的年份价格酒庄定价太高了，那么可能你有另外一种选择方式，就是去选择其他的一些叫没有在伟大年份的 shadow， 就是在影子笼罩之下的那一些年份。
So for among the more recent vintages, if you look at what happened since 2010, the vintage that's in the market right now that you can find widely is 2012. And 12, one of the reasons why it offers to me very good value is because 10 was so high, 11, the price started coming down. It didn't come down quite enough. So even though 12 was a better vintage than 11, the prices are lower. Because the market was demanding that 9 and 10 were too expensive, so the prices were on a decline, and 12 being a very good vintage, it's not one of the greatest, but very good vintage, and widely available, I think it offers good value.
刚刚经理呢提到就是对于各个年份它的一个品质跟价格之间关系来阐述年份对于葡萄酒影响这个问题，比如说10年呢，像因为它是一个比较不错的年份，所以毋庸置疑的，它价格会稍微 高一点。然后接下来11年呢，实际上它的品质呢并没有那么的好。12年呢，相对来说整体的年情呢要比11年要好一点。但是呢，非常奇怪的是，就是12年呢，它的价格呢整体上要比11年要更低，所以相对来说12年呢是一个性价比非常非常不错的年份。
So then we come to 2013, which was a very challenging vintage and a small crop. So 14 came, and 14 is a good vintage, but not in the same category and quality league as 2015. And so when the 15 comes around, you see that a lot of people have great interest in it. But there is a little bit of a debate as to how good the 2015 vintage is.
接下来是13年、14年跟15年。13年跟14年也是一个两个比较艰难的年份。对啊，最后15年终于出现了，伟大的年份出现了。当然有些人对于15年份的看法呢可能会不一样。我们接下来就看看基尼是怎么说的。
For me, the way I judge a 2015 vintage or any vintage, especially when you taste it on premiere, these are baby wines in barrel. The way that I judge the final quality of the vintage is not by the greatest wines, because the best wines, vintage after vintage, usually make very consistent high-quality wines. What you really need to judge is across different appellations, and across different quality levels from first growth all the way down to the basic generic Bordeaux AOC. And what I tasted in the lineup is that from the top to the bottom, 2015 was consistently good. And if there was one appellation that might have been a little bit weaker was in the north, in Saint-Estèphe, where they had a lot more rain than in the middle or southern part of the Medoc. But aside from that little difference, I found 2015 to be exceptional because it was consistently good across all quality levels.
对于基尼来说啊，15年份呢实际上是一个非常非常伟大的年份。对于伟大年份的定义呢，基尼是通过从最顶级到比较 basic 的、比较基础的这些波尔多它的质量来判断这个年份到底是怎么样的。他认为呢，15年呢是一个质量比较稳定、比较平均的一个年份。就是即使是你是从一些非常入门级的酒款去品尝的话，它的品质呢也是非常非常的不错的。
So there were a lot of great 2015s. As I said, there were across the board. I really didn't find many poor wines. And in difficult vintages, you do find them. And here we have two wines from 2015 that I particularly was impressed with, especially given where they are in the price point ratio. They're mostly reasonably priced and not like a first or second growth pricing. And in 2015 offered amazing quality. One is Smith & Lafite.
我觉得当时说这么多，我只想用一句话来概括他所想表达的意思，就是2015年份没有不好的酒，对于波尔多来说。然后呢，他提到15年份呢、啊、有一款酒呢，他是非常推荐的，就是 Smith & Lafite。
And of course, this is not the 2015 because it's not available. It's 2012.
这是我们酒窖里面珍藏的2012年份的。葡萄酒，因为二零一五年份现在是不可能有酒标的，所以呢，我们也不可能有这个 white bottle 在这里。
The Smith & Lafite in Passec Léognan is one of the rising stars of the region. It's, I think, for most people who love white wine from Bordeaux, they know Smith & Lafite because of its fantastic white. But the reds have been starting to receive a better and better reception because the quality has gone up tremendously.And in 2015, they really, among all the recent vintages of Smith & Lafite that I've tasted, it is among the very, very best for the red.
对于Smith & Lafite来说，喜欢波尔多白葡萄酒的人都知道 Smith & Lafite家的白葡萄酒非常非常的不错。但是他惊喜的发现就是，Smith & Lafite家的 红葡萄酒呢，实际上近年来有一个非常非常大的品质的提升。15年份呢，他认为是史密斯大威近几个年份当中最好的一个。
So again, we have then, you know, going a little north to Puglia, another wine in 2015 that I really enjoyed a lot was Ponte Canet. And many people know that Ponte Canet is well known for the biodynamic farming, all the horses in their vineyard, and all the care that they're putting in the vineyard, rather than, well, you know, lots of different kinds of winemaking. Although the owner, Alfred Tesseron, he is known to experiment with interesting vessels like cement concrete eggs. They are shaped like an egg made out of concrete, so he does do a lot of experimentation, but it's really in the viticulture and the vineyard where he spends a lot of his attention to detail.
另外一款Ginny 比较推荐的酒就是他尝到了2015年份的庞特卡奈。庞特卡奈啊，这里有几个关键词要跟大家分享一下，一个就是非常特别的，叫做水泥蛋。第二个呢，就是生物动力。第三个呢，就是马。这三样东西啊，实际上非常非常独特。现在的庄主呢，Alfred Tesseron。OK， 他在葡萄园的经营啊、管理啊，甚至在酿酒的方法上面啊，他是实际上是一个可以说是一个先驱，他可以，或者他说他愿意，很愿意去尝试各种各样的experimental methods， 所以呢，他可以获得更多的让人意想不到的结果。
So these are just some examples of 2015 that I think still offer good value because the wines are so terrific among the best they've made. And their pricing is definitely not as high as 09 or 10.
15年份的庞特卡奈呢，实际上它也是一个性价比非常不错的葡萄酒，至少相从质量、从定价的策略上面来讲的话，它比09年、比10年要更值得去购买。
So should we take a few more questions from the audience?
Sure.
Okay, let me choose.
I choose it for you. Some of our clients is asking because they have already bought some of our premium wine.
Oh, the 2015.
Yes, 2015. Uh-huh. So he is asking when will be the best time to drink 2015?
Oh, which wine? First growth? Like
Ponte Canet.
Oh, like Ponte Canet 2015.
Uh-huh. Maybe I can make a...
Yes. Mm-hmm.
好，首先给大家翻译一下，就是我们有一位已经购买了我们波尔多79的用户，他在问2015年份的葡萄酒到底什么时候喝最合适，譬如说这一款那个庞特卡奈来说。
I have an easy answer for those who are asking about when to drink 2015. If you're over 50 years old, give it to your children. It's for them to drink.
哎呀，吉尼刚刚提到，就是说，如果说，其实这个问题也非常简单了，就是如果说你现在已经过了50岁了，你可以把这款酒保留给你的孙子。
If you're between 30 and 40, then you will enjoy this wine in your retirement.
如果你现在呢是啊，譬如说30到40岁这个期间，那么你15年的酒呢，你可以留到你退休的时候再来喝了。
And for the first growth, if you have any of, let's say, Latour, Lafite in 2015, I would say your grandchildren would really appreciate it.
如果说是对那特别是那些顶级的葡萄酒来说的话，到那个时候，你的孙子去喝这些酒的时候， 一定会非常非常欣赏这些酒的。这样，总结一下基尼的意思就是说，实际上15年份的酒啊，它具有非常不错的 aging potential， right？
Yes， aging potential。
这才是基尼真正想去说的。那你什么时候去喝，实际上都
对。Okay， should we take a few more questions？
Where is the best place or channel to buy on Pima?
Where is the best channel and place?
Wineworld.com.
Surely.
I can. Also, actually, you know, Ginny, we have already set up Hong Kong office, right?
Yes.
实际上，红酒世界呢，在香港呢已经成立了一个。
So you don't have to pay duty.
Yes,、mm-hmm. 成立一个香港公司。香港公司购买汽酒的一个好处呢，就是你不用去交关税。
So with On Premier, you have to be very careful who you're buying from, because the last thing you want is to pay money and wait 2 years.And if something has happened to the company, if they're not big or reliable enough, or don't have the reputation that you trust, then you may end up never getting your wine. So there have been many companies that have shut down because they actually took the money but didn't actually purchase the wine. Mm-hmm. So it's really trusting your merchant and understanding, you know, that there is a risk involved. But if you go with somebody very reputable and reliable, mm-hmm. then...That takes care of most of your concern.
君毅刚刚提到，就是说在七九购买的过程当中，需要特别注意的就是一个渠道的问题，因为渠道呢不单单是在你运输的过程当中，在七九上市之后，你在运输当中会采取更好的方式去保护你的葡萄酒，更重要的就是在你购买的这个渠道当中呢，它过了两年，它会不会倒闭了？会不会拿不到酒了？会不会拿了你的钱，然后就不去给你买酒，直接把钱卷走了？这才是一个现在购买基酒所应该真正去注意的问题。
Should we take one or two more questions?
Also about the On Premier.
Okay.
If someone wants to invest in 2015 on Pima, what information channel he'd better take notice to diminish the risk?
Well, here's the thing about On Premier. Here's my advice for people who are thinking of buying On Premier now or next year or even in the past. I really think that the smartest thing to do is not think of On Premier as just an investment.Because if you want to just make an investment and make money, then you can go into stocks or real estate or so many options where the end goal is purely to make money. But for wine, I think that you also need to take some pleasure in it. And part of going into and buying On Premier is to follow the wine and see how it ages, how it develops, and get, you know, joy and pleasure that you can't put a value on.
Mm-hmm.
So that's my first message, and then I'll get to the question.
对于经理来说呢，他认为基酒呢，它不应该单纯的做一个投资这样一种渠道，因为投资有很多很多方式，你并不一定要选择基酒作为投资。更重要的就是说，在你购买基酒的这个过程当中呢，你可以去追随某一款酒，可以收集各个不同的年份，可以通过这样一种渠道去享受到葡萄酒给你所带来的乐趣，这才是真正非常非常重要的，或者对于基酒购买者来说非常非常值得去推荐的这样的方式。
Where to go for wine investment information? I think one of the best sites is LiveX. A lot of their analysis and reports are free. Another site, if you go into winesearcher.com and you look at specific wines, they've created a really interesting chart for you about the prices for that wine over the last, you know, decade or so. So you get a sense of the value of that wine. So those two sites give you information about tracking the wine and how it fits in to the previous vintages and prices.
对于信息来源的渠道呢，刚刚就你提到了一个叫 Livex，Livex呢，它是全称叫做伦敦国际葡萄酒交易所，实际上红酒世界跟这个Livex 呢也建立了一定的联系，它会定期提供给我们资讯跟文章。 我们同时呢会在我们自己的网站上面去发布相关的期酒的一个信息，每像15年的期酒，我们也会对它进行一个跟踪，有相应的市场的信息啊，酒庄发布的信息啊等等发布出来。And
for general news on wine investment in 2015 Bordeaux, I think the sites that have very frequent articles and updates about price movements is Drinks Business or Decanter. Wine Spectator also follows wine prices. And in China, you have Wine World because they take all the greatest news from all over and have it on their site on a regular basis. So that's how you follow and track how you know, the fine wine market is going.
如果对于葡萄酒期酒方面的信息来说的话呢，国际上的网站呢有Drink Business， 有 Decanter， 有 Wine Spectator。 其中呢，Drink Business actually has signed a contract with us， so we are cooperator。 像我们跟Drink Business 实际上已经达成了一个合作的协议，我们也会在接下来长期的去合作。 这些网站都是非常不错的网站。如果说是在国内的话呢，实际上红酒世界网呢就是一个非常不错的期酒信息的来源。So, right now, I want to ask Jeannie a question that is, yes, does it make sense to buy on Prima? 就是我刚刚所问的问题，就是说，我们了解了这么多，就是购买期酒到底合适还是不合适？Well,
it's a big question because it's one that also gets asked very often for me. And I would say it always makes sense to buy on Premier if wine is your passion. And if you're buying it because you love wine and what you want to do is follow the life of a wine from the beginning to the end. It's the greatest option. Pricing, of course, is another story, but for pure wine lovers, why not understand and know that your wine has come directly from the chateau to the négociant and via your merchant who brings it in for you and then to your cellar and nowhere else?
这是一个比较大的问题。 经理呢也遇到很多人问他这样的一个问题，这个问题呢主要取决于你自己对于葡萄酒有没有一种追随它各个年份的这样一种热情，而且呢通你要知道通过这样一种期酒购买的方式啊，你可以知道你的酒呢是直接从酒庄到达那个 negotiation， 再到达你的 wine merchant， 再到达你的手里，这样一种保证你的渠道是正确的，而且保证你的酒
So you can see that actually the movement of the wine has been very minimal because even though it has gone from courtier, négociant to merchant before you received it, it hasn't actually physically moved that much. It's only gone from the chateau to a warehouse where the négociant may keep the wine and then directly to the consumers right away. So unless you keep it in a bonded warehouse, the movement of the wine is very minimum, and this traceability, which is very important, because if you can trace the wine and you know the provenance, you know that it has to be genuine and real. No chance of fake wines.
对于Jeannie来说呢，他刚刚提到，对于期酒啊，无论你是从哪个渠道去购买，你所需要非常注意的。 就是一个叫做溯源，就追溯。你要知道你的酒从酒商出来到了酒商那里，这个过程它的运输合不合适；从酒商出来到进口商那里，这个运输的过程它有没有采取 合适的方式，有没有，譬如说有没有采取合适的温度啊，合适的条件去运输这些葡萄酒，还有就是你的供应商，你所购买这些葡萄酒的渠道，他有没有采取一种合适的方式去保管你的葡萄酒。这个溯源呢，对于这些酒来说的品质影响很大，也非常非常的重要。
You can also choose the size and format of the wines you want. Half bottles, magnums, double magnums, imperials. You can keep them and see these wines age. That is the beauty. And really, I mean, for us who love wine for what it is, there's really no price, no comparison. So en premier, buying as direct from source as you can is one of the best options.
Mm-hmm.对于那些对于葡萄酒的包装规格，譬如说它是半瓶装的、750毫升的，或者是那个 Magnum 的，购买基酒呢，都可以选择非常非常不错的这样一种方式来满足你的需求。
But if your goal in buying on premier is purely to make money, I would say go into real estate in Shenzhen.
刚刚经理提到，就是说，如果说你通过购买曲酒想单独来获利，或者把它认为只是一种牟利投资的方式的话，那么你就去买深圳的房子吧。
I think we have a few minutes to take one or two questions from.
Sure, I will check.
Okay.
I will choose a most frequently asked question that is, recommendation.
Okay.
What wines of2015 will you highly recommend it to buy? What is the best region for this vintage?
Here's two. I think I just did Ponte Canet and Smith of Lafitte, but I think a lot of the wines, you don't have to go to the top because the top first growths, they were fabulous. It's true. But you almost expect it because they are supposed to be the best. So I would go from anywhere between second to third, fourth, fifth growths, and a lot of the second growths made fantastic wine. Both Pichon Baron, Pichon Lalande were terrific. The Margaux appellation this year, the whole appellation, not just Chateau Margaux, was also phenomenal. I was also very impressed with the Pessac-Léognan appellation. Both... from the, you know, the top wines, of course, Aubryon, but Obailly was beautiful, Domaine de Chevalier. There were so many, but if you want to just go for Appellation, Pauillac, Margaux, Pessac-Léognan.
对于基酒的推荐，基尼给出我们的建议是这样的，顶级的，像一级庄啊，各个分级的一级庄，实际上我们毋庸置疑的，它肯定是非常非常不错的。如果说你想稍微性价比，或者叫你不想花那么大的价钱去买这些一级庄的话呢，你可以选择二级庄啊到五级庄。它非常推荐的，像我们刚刚提到的那个Smith Olafie and then Ponte Canet 庞德卡奈，还有就是我们的壁上女爵、壁上男爵。侯伯王还有那个高百利都是非常非常不错的葡萄酒。那对于产区来说的话，他认为他自己比较喜欢的呢，一个就是马格产区，另外一个的话就是佩萨克雷奥良，再有一个的话就是波雅克。他认为这三个产区几乎所有的酒庄都酿造出了非常非常不错的2015年份的葡萄酒。
Do we have time for one more question, Stephanie? Yes, one more.
So.I will check whether we...
Frequently asked questions.
Yes, frequently asked question. How to
take part in the on-premier tasting week?
Oh, how to take part?
Yes.
If you are a consumer?You mean, or as a,
yes, consumer. 就是刚刚我们有用户也提到，就是说，如何参加七九品鉴周？如果是作为一个普通的消费者
，So there are several thousand people who are invited every spring, usually in April, to participate in tasting en primaire, and they have to be invited by the Union des Grands Crus, who organizes this tasting. And around the UGC, you have all the other chateaus also opening their doors. And often you need to, if you don't have an invitation, the best way really is to ask your merchant and your supplier to see if you can tag along, because the en primaire tasting is really for the trade, not for consumers.
对于我们的用户刚刚提到的，就是如何参加波尔多的七酒品鉴。 据你提出来，就是说每一年的春天啊，实际上是每年的波尔多七酒品鉴会举办的时间。它实际上呢，它是一个针对专业葡萄酒品鉴者的一个引荐会了。它采取的是一种邀请制，每年呢，波尔多的列级酒庄联合会呢都会采取这样一种方式去邀请。另外一种呢，就是有些 酒商呢，他也会邀请他自己的客户去参加，所以整体来说的话呢，并不是有很多的消费者会直接参加到这样的一场品鉴会当中。I
think we're out of time, Yasgur.
Sure, thank you.
You did a great job.
thank you, Ginny. So thank you for your explanation of the 2015 Ampere.
I hope everyone learned something.
非常高兴，真的谢谢我们的Ginny今天晚上来到我们的红酒世界直播间，为我们详细的解释了，或者是为我们详细的介绍了2015年份这样一个年份。然后呢，红酒世界现在还有很多的非常不错的2015年份的七酒，无论是从我们的国内啊，还是从我们香港分公司都有渠道去购买。 如果各位观众有兴趣或者有任何的问题，也可以在稍后在我们的互动屏幕下面去留言。然后 Ginny 呢 ，will answer your questions later.
Oh,
谢谢大家。
Thank you. 谢谢。
See you.
谢谢。
Bye bye.
Bye.
Cut.